Hi, welcome to this video lecture. This is Praveena to teach you class 7 lesson 2 nutrition in plants. As you have already studied in lesson 1, plants are the only organisms on this planet that can prepare their own food through the process of photosynthesis. But whereas animals, as they cannot prepare their food, they completely depend upon the plants. They depend on the plants directly by eating the plants or indirectly by eating the animals that eat plants. Now let us see how the process of nutrition in animals takes place. Nutrition in animals. Animal nutrition, it includes nutrient requirement and the mode of intake of food and its utility in the body. So here, the components of food such as carbohydrates, they are the complex substances that can be utilized by the body. So they have to be broken down into simpler ones. So this process of breaking down of complex components into simpler substances is known as digestion. The mode of intake of food, it varies in different organisms. For example, bees and hummingbirds, they suck the nectar from the plants. Whereas snakes like python, they swallow the prey completely. In case of butterfly, they involve the process of siphoning. Whereas in snake, they scrap the blood from the animals. So the mode of nutrition is different in different organisms. So now let us see how the process of digestion, it goes on in human beings. And what are all the different parts that are involved in the process of digestion. So here in the picture, you can see the digestive canal, which is being divided into various compartments. So we organisms take in the food through the mouth, and the food is getting digested and utilized by the body, whereas the unused part gets defecated. So the digestive canal, it involves, it starts with the mouth or the buccal cavity. Then the food goes into the tube-like structure known as esophagus, or it is also known as the food pipe. From there it enters into the stomach, small intestine, large intestine, rectum and anus. So the alimentary canal, it starts with the mouth buccal cavity and ends with the anus. So here when we intake the food, all the components of food, they get digested and move on through the different compartments. Behind that, there are also different glands that help in the secretion of digestive juices. The walls of the stomach, the intestine and the glands such as salivary glands, liver and pancreas, they secrete the digestive juices that help in breakdown of these complex components into simpler ones. So here the digestive system, all the parts of the digestive system along with the digestive glands constitute the digestive system, or it is also known as alimentary canal. Now let us see how the process of digestion, it goes on in the human body. So here in the mouth or the buccal cavity, we take in the food into the mouth. So this process of taking food into the body is known as ingestion. You chew the food with the help of teeth. The teeth are located in the sockets, separate sockets called gums. They help in mechanically grinding or breaking down the food particles into simple ones. So here you can see in the picture the variation in the teeth, right? So all the teeth are not similar. They are they vary in appearance and their function is also different. So there are four set of teeth in the human being known as incisors, canines, premolars and molars. So an adult human being consists of 32 teeth. Now let us see what are all the functions of these teeth. So here the first teeth, that is the first the front teeth of the mouth, that is incisors, they help in cutting and biting of the teeth, and their number is 8. Next coming the piercing and tearing teeth, they are known as canines and they are 4 in number. Whereas chewing and grinding teeth, so both molars and premolars, they help in chewing and grinding the teeth, and their total number is 20. So an adult human being consists of 32 teeth. So they help in cutting and biting, piercing and tearing, chewing and grinding the food. Do you remember the loss of your teeth when you are in the infancy stage? The first set of growth that grows in the infancy stage are called as the milk teeth, and they last for 6 to 8 years. And the second set of teeth that replaces them are the permanent teeth. These teeth may last lifelong, or you may lose it at the age when you are old or due to some dental defects. Now let us see. So in the mouth and buccal cavity, we have taken the food which is being masticated or chewed by the teeth. Now that which enters has to enter into the esophagus. Before that, when you chew the food particle, you see that saliva is being secreted by the salivary glands. And the three pairs of salivary glands are parotid gland, sublingual gland and submandibular gland. So these glands secrete the saliva and help in digestion of the carbohydrates. So let us see the action of saliva on starch. So carbohydrate is a form of starch, right? So here we have taken two test tubes. In test tube 1, we have added teaspoonful of boiled rice, and in test tube B, we have added 1 teaspoonful of chewed rice. We have to chew the food for 3 to 4 minutes, and that consistency has to be taken into the test tube B. Now, as you have studied in Classic, this experiment for carbohydrates, how can we identify the presence of carbohydrates? It is with the help of iodine, isn't it? So here, when we add, to both the test tubes, after adding the boiled rice, you have to add 2 or 3 ml of water to it. Now stir it properly, and now add 2 or 3 drops of iodine to each of the test tube. So what is the variation that you can see in both the test tubes? In test tube 1, the change in color is blue. So here, that which is telling that the starch, as it is a kind of carbohydrates, it has converted its color to blue or black. But whereas in the test tube B, as the food is being chewed with the help of saliva, so saliva has got few enzymes which can convert the starch into sugars. So the starch here in test tube B has been converted into sugars. So there is no change in color in test tube B. So this proves the action of saliva on starch. So saliva consists of an enzyme known as salivary amylase or ptyalin. So these acts on the carbohydrates and break down them into the simpler substances. So now the food is present in the mouth, right? Which is being masticated by the teeth. The teeth cut these food particles into smaller pieces. So what is the use of tongue? We all know that it helps us in talking. And also, it mixes the saliva with the food during chewing and help in swallowing the food. Right. And also, we taste the food with our tongue. What does this tongue consist of? It consists of taste bud that help to detect the taste of different tastes, such as sweet, salt, sour and bitter. So, in the picture, it is clear that, so the sweet is tested by the taste buds in the front region. So in such a way where the taste can be detected by the taste buds which are present in the tongue. So we taste food with our tongue. So now normally some kind of bacteria which are not harmful to our body are present in our mouth. But when you do not clean your mouth or teeth after eating, you might see that some harmful bacteria start growing along with the food, and they convert these sugars into acids, that which leads to the tooth decay. So children, you have to clean your mouth twice a day after having your meals. And also, sometimes you might have experienced while you are eating in a hurry, you may talk or laugh, right? You might have experienced a kind of cough, or you may get hiccups or choking sensation. So why this is happening? This is due to when we take in the food material, sometimes the food material may obstruct the windpipe, that which leads to choking. when you go in the throat, it is the common passage for both food and air. Air we take in through the nostril and enters the windpipe. So when we are swallowing the food particles, what happens is, as these two pipes are adjacent to each other, when we swallow the food, a flap-like structure known as epiglottis, it closes the windpipe, so and channelizing the food directly into the food pipe, that what is called as esophagus. So when this food particle enter into the windpipe, you might have experienced that process of cough or hiccups or choking sensation. So while eating, you should not do such activities. Now the food, after proper mastication, it enter into a tube like structure known as food pipe or esophagus. So here in the picture you can see some walls of these esophagus is being enlarged. So such movements are known as peristaltic movements. So through the process of peristalsis, the food enters from the food pipe or esophagus, it enters into the stomach. So here the tube like structure that which is shown on the screen is the esophagus. So the peristaltic movements are helping out the food to enter into the stomach. Now let us see what happens in the stomach and what are all the digestive juices that are produced in the stomach. So the stomach, it is a thick walled bag which is shaped like a flattened J. And here the inner walls of the stomach, they secrete mucus, and the hydrochloric acid and digestive juices are being produced in the stomach. The acid kills many bacteria that enter along with the food. So here the digestive juices that which are secreted by the stomach, they help in the breakdown the proteins into simpler substances. So the function of the stomach was known, was being seen in a strange accident. Let us see what happened. So in the year 1822, a person named Alexis St. Martin, he was hit by a shotgun. And his chest walls are being damaged, greatly damaged, and it made a hole in his stomach. So he was brought to an American doctor named William Beaumont, and this doctor could save the patient, but he was unable to close the hole which is made in the stomach, so it was left unbandaged. So William Beaumont, he took it as a great opportunity and to see what is happening in the stomach. So here, William Beaumont, he observed that the food is being digested in the stomach and the stomach is churning the food materials in it, and he also observed that the stomach walls are producing few digestive juices that which are helping out to digest the food material, and he also observed that the food material, it is entering into the small intestine only once the digestion in the stomach has been completed. So now the partly digested food from the stomach, it enters into the intestine. So the small intestine, it is a highly coiled and 7.5 meters long. It receives the secretion from both the liver and pancreas. Whereas it walls also secrete few digestive juices to digest the carbohydrates, proteins and fats. And here, a gland known as liver, which is a reddish brown gland, which is present in the upper part of the abdomen towards the right side, and the main function of this liver, and it is the largest gland, it secretes bile. So bile is stored in a sac like structure known as gallbladder. So it secretes the bile, and the function of the bile here is it helps in the digestion of fats. If we can also say that it helps in the emulsification of fats. Below the stomach, there is another gland named pancreas, which is cream-colored gland, and it also acts on carbohydrates, fats and proteins. So after the digestion in the small intestine, it just goes into the lower level of the small intestine, where the further digestion of these components takes place. Here, after the proper digestion in the small intestine, the carbohydrates are being converted into glucose, fats are converted into fatty acids and glycerols, whereas proteins are converted into amino acids. So here the small intestine is receiving the secretions from the intestinal walls. Along with that, it also receives the secretions from liver as well as pancreas. So now, as the digestion is being completed in the small intestine, the process of absorption has to be taken place in the small intestine. So here, the small intestine, inside it consists of small finger-like projections known as villi. So villi increases the surface area of absorption. So the villi are surrounded by the wet blood vessels. So the digested food particles has to be absorbed by the blood vessels here. So here the digested food particles are moving through the blood vessels via to different organs of the body. So where they have to prepare different components, substances are being produced there, where they have to build complex substances such as proteins in different organs of the body. So such a process is known as assimilation. So after complete utilization of the food material, where the energy is being released out. Now the undigested food particles from the small intestine, it enters into the large intestine. So here the large intestine, it is wider and shorter than the small intestine, and it is about 1.5 meter length. It absorbs water and some salts from the undigested food particles, whereas the remaining waste enter into the rectum, and from the rectum the fecal matter is removed out through the anus. So this process of removal of the undigested food particles through the anus is known as egestion. Sometimes you might have experienced the need to pass watery stool, right? So that condition is known as diarrhea. And this is most common in India, and usually in children this is most commonly seen. So here, where there is loss of salts and water from the body, so before consulting a doctor, that patient have to be given boiled and warm water with a pinch of salt and sugar added to it. So that is called as oral rehydration solution. Till now we have seen how the process of digestion has taken place in human beings. Now let us see how that it goes on in animals. So you might have seen cows or buffaloes which are chewing the grass even when they are not eating them. Yes, you might have seen that. So these animals, they just eat the grass and store it in a stomach, the part of a stomach which is known as a rumen. So this partly digested food which is stored in the rumen is known as cud. And these animals in their free time, leisurely, they sit, just bring back this cud into the mouth and chew it again lumpwise and take it back into the digestive system. So such a process is called as rumination, and the animals which undergo this process are known as ruminants. And the grass is rich in cellulose. So here when you see the picture, a bag-like structure known as cecum, which is present in between the esophagus and the small intestine. This cecum consists of bacteria that help in the digestion of cellulose, that which is absent in human beings. So that is what we don't eat grass, right? So now, as we have seen the process of digestion, as these animals have got a proper digestive system, they take in the food through their mouth and the process of digestion goes on in the stomach. But whereas there are few organisms, even though they don't consist of mouth or the stomach, they undergo the process of digestion. So let us now see how the process of digestion in these organisms takes place. So here in this picture you can see an unicellular organism named amoeba. So it is a single cell microorganisms which is found in the pond water. It can change its shape. It doesn't have any mouth or a particular digestive system is not inbuilt in its body, but still the process of digestion goes on in amoeba. So here you can see it has some projection like structures known as pseudopodia. So pseudopodia, these are the fault feet like structures. So whenever amoeba, it comes in contact with the food, or whenever it senses the food, it pushes out its pseudopodia and surrounds the food particles and engulf the food into its body. This food particle is present, is sent into the vacuole. So here the vacuole, where it secretes few digestive juices, and the food particles get digested in the vacuole, whereas the undigested food particle are thrown out or they are expelled out of the body. So this is how the process of trapping of food or the digestion of food takes place in amoeba.